Well, Steve, thank you for the introduction, and thank you to Advanced Energy Economy for hosting this panel and this important gathering of policymakers, executives, entrepreneurs. As Steve mentioned, we're here to talk about transportation. Transportation is one of the most challenging pillars of the energy economy. If you think about everything we do in the industrial world, in a modern industrial economy, you've got power, you've got agriculture, you've got manufacturing, you've got transportation. We've made a lot of progress in a lot of those areas from a clean energy perspective, but transportation is one of the toughest ones. And as Steve mentioned, in the state of California, we actually have a higher mix of greenhouse gas impact from the transportation sector from the power sector. And a lot of that is based on advancements we've made in the power sector, but it's also because transportation is uniquely difficult to drive efficiency into. And you're going to hear from our panelists today about the different markets that they serve, about how challenging it is to compete with crude oil in those markets, but also what the near-term opportunities are that they're going after. So when you think about transportation, especially in the perspective of California, it is our largest source of greenhouse gas emissions. It's also responsible for some of our more challenging local air quality problems. And that has a direct impact on human health in California, and that has a direct price tag. So this is a really expensive problem to go after. If you think about the risk that the transportation sector is exposed to from an energy perspective, I actually think transportation is at more risk than any other sector because you're tied to a single commodity. You read a lot about natural gas, you read a lot about electric vehicles and biofuels, but if you look at the numbers, the cost of moving anything, whether it's people to and from work, whether it's goods in the state of California, it's entirely correlated to the price of crude oil. And while there are a lot of promising stories about shale production and oil sands and unconventional oil plays in the United States, and oil production is growing in the United States, the problem is oil is a global market. So every incremental barrel that we produce, we're bidding against China and India for that barrel. And so when I woke up this morning, in addition to really exciting stories about new oil production in the US, I checked oil prices. Brent was $109 a barrel, WTI was $106. A couple years ago, those would be considered crisis prices, but we've just kind of gotten used to paying around $100 a barrel to move anything or to go to work. That's a huge tax on families and businesses in California. So we've got to do something about this single source exposure, and you're going to hear from executives as well as Curt, who comes from a policy side, in terms of what we're trying to get done. You know, the last thing I mentioned before I transition over to introducing the panelists is that even if we could keep up with 90 million barrels a day indefinitely, as you've heard from previous speakers and from our keynote, we can't afford that carbon bill. So while oil and gas will continue to play a vital part in our transportation economy, we've got to do more with less carbon-based fuel. And again, we'll talk about some strategies for accomplishing that. So that's the problem in summary. As Steve mentioned, I work at Kleiner Perkins. I'm a venture capital investor, and prior to that, I've worked in a couple startups, all focused around mobility and transportation. The best part of my job is working with executives like Dimitrios, like Andrew, like Martin. I work with a host of companies at Kleiner, and they're all trying to bring innovative entrepreneurial solutions. And that's, I think, what California is uniquely equipped to do very well, is to develop new technology, get a sense of what the market's really going to acquire, and drive rapid adoption. So I've described the problem in summary. And let's jump into some of the potential solutions. And I think the best way for an innovation economy like California to talk about some of those solutions is to have some of the innovative companies and executives talk about what they're doing directly, tell you about what's working and what challenges are in their way to accelerating adoption. A lot of what we're seeing in transportation today is a really great story about early adoption. But everything we do as investors, once a company is in revenue and shipping, is thinking about how to move faster on that adoption curve. And for the clean energy economy, moving faster means carbon that we don't emit, it means health problems that we don't incur, it means increased energy security. So we want to think about how we go from success stories around early adopters to getting that early majority and then finally the mass market. So we've got a great set of panelists. I'm honored to moderate this group. Really interesting, diverse set of backgrounds and success stories in individual markets. So first off, let me introduce Martin Sabarsky, CEO of Cellana Biofuels. Martin's been leading Cellana since 2011. It's been a really exciting time for the company. Cellana is focused on algae-based biofuels, and they're taking that sustainable feedstock into the food market, nutrition, feed, and lastly into fuel. You'll hear about a really interesting deployment opportunity that Cellana now has with one of the largest oil producers in the world, also one of the largest biodiesel producers in the world. So it's an interesting model we'll go through. We also have Andrew Smith, CEO of ATDynamics. ATDynamics is one of the most exciting stories I've come across in sustainable transportation. It's a great example of entrepreneurship, technology, and of a very capital efficient business model. A lot of what we hear about clean energy is it's so capital intensive. Can the venture capital sector keep up? Can it continue to fund more expensive projects and factories? When you hear about the ATDynamics case study, it's a very traditional California Silicon Valley style approach to getting to market quickly on limited capital resources and really focusing on solving a valuable problem. ATDynamics is an aerodynamics technology company. They serve the class 7 and 8 long haul trucking market. That is an incredibly demanding market. As you'll hear from Andrew, that's a thin margin, incredibly competitive space, and these are operators that are moving trucks 100 to 200,000 miles a year. So it's unforgiving, it's brutal, and they have no tolerance for new technology that doesn't work 100%. I'm also excited to introduce Dimitrios Papadogonas.
Got that right.
There we go. Dimitrios is the chief marketing officer of ChargePoint. Previously, he was with Virgin America. ChargePoint is the leading company in EV charging infrastructure. I'm excited because Dimitrios is going to make EV charging as fun, as exciting as flying Virgin America. So after doing a great job of revolutionizing the way we think about low-cost domestic carrier flights, Dimitrios moved over and is applying those talents to EV infrastructure. Like ATDynamics, which has saved 6 million gallons of diesel fuel for truckers, ChargePoint is also making a serious dent in gasoline consumption, a lot of which is in California. Because as you know, a lot of the early EVs are going to the state of California. So I think last 12 months, ChargePoint has offset about 3 million gallons of consumption. So we've got a ways to go, but we're on the right track, and we're finally starting to make a dent in some of these fuels. Lastly, it's my pleasure to introduce Curt Augustine. I think Curt is a great complement to a panel where we have three clean energy executives. Curt is the director of policy with the Automotive Alliance, or the Automobile Manufacturers Alliance. And I think Curt can provide a policy view and a strategic view of what the automobile manufacturers are thinking as they consider these advanced technologies in transportation. So Curt doesn't represent any one company in particular, but represents the voice of the industry. And the Alliance of Automobile Manufacturers has a number of interesting campaigns going on. They're front and center in this discussion around job growth and the criticality of manufacturing. I think advanced transportation technology offers a great way to add more value in the product itself and less in a disposable combustible fuel. So they're an important member in that conversation. They've also got important campaigns going on around safety and child safety with automobiles. So we'll jump into those topics. So that's the introduction of our great and diverse panelists. Just a process reminder, as we get going here, if you have a question or a suggestion for what you'd like to hear from us, just write it on a 3x5 card, raise your hand, and get it to one of the moderators, and I'll incorporate it into the discussion. So that's my intro. Let me hand it over to the executives themselves. Martin, why don't we start with you? If you would, why don't you give us more detail about what's going on currently with your company and your products that you're developing?
Great. Well, thank you very much, Ryan, and thank you to Graham and the rest of AEE for the opportunity to present here. Hopefully, it's a very friendly rather than hostile audience. Because you understand that it's an imperative, not just in California, but throughout the world, to become more independent of carbon and some other critical resources. What we'll talk about as part of my opening remarks about Cellana is the fact that energy and ag are inextricably linked when you think about biofuels. And at Cellana, what we and a growing number of leading edge companies in the algae biomass space are trying to pioneer is what's in this bottle right here, which is an industrial scale, essentially high-tech farming technology to come up with a feedstock that can serve as a basis for energy applications like liquid transportation fuels. And as much as we really do want to see a lot of wind and solar, we're going to be living with liquid transportation fuels in aircrafts and other transportation vehicles for quite some time. And it also offers the opportunity for baseload power generation rather than just peaking. And so it's a nice complement as part of an all-of-the-above strategy for an advanced energy economy. So at Cellana, we've been working really for the past 15 years for coming up with an industrial-scale farming technology to take natural ocean-based algae and grow it outdoors consistently day after day, week after week, year after year. And I'm pleased to report that where we are right now is less on the technology side. We're done with that, and more of our peers are too in the algae space. We're focused in the last 2 years, while I've been CEO of Cellana, on business model innovation. What is the right strategy? What's the right product mix to be able to bring advanced biofuels from algae and other products to the market? I'm very pleased to report that the strategy that we came up with, which is to take strains of algae that can make a large volume of fuel-grade oils, but that also make a small but very meaningful volume of high-value omega-3 oils represented by this small vial of liquid gold, allow us to really do both at the same time. This is a strategy which allows us to be profitable, but also sell the residual oils for fuel applications and the residual proteins after you pull out the omega-3s for animal feed or food opportunities. And so this is how it really addresses both energy and ag. Leveraging this three-product business model over the last 2 years successfully has been my challenge. I'm pleased to report that 10 weeks ago we signed the world's largest offtake agreement for an algae-based crude oil with Neste Oil, the Exxon of Finland, and the largest refiner of diesel from non-petroleum sources in the world. Their product, NextBTL, is supplied worldwide, including here in California. And the great thing about the NextBTL renewable diesel product, unlike biodiesel, is it is the same exact chemical as diesel from fossil fuels. It just comes from a non-petroleum source, such as Malaysian palm oil or soybean oil or animal fats or the like. And so what was really key to that deal, which is we hope it is transformative not just for Cellana but for the whole industry, is it shows a path where you can be profitable at current costs of production today, at current yields, and at current prices for oil at $100 a barrel, for soy meal or fish meal that's addressed by the residual algae meal, and for algae-based omega-3s. And for us, what was critical in figuring out and getting Neste to salute, if you will, in our contract, is that this liquid gold retails in products today that are supplemented by some of our competitors at between 1,000 and 10,000 times the price of oil for fuel. And when you can do both, you have not just a low carbon fuel, but what you have is something which is even more sustainable from a fresh water usage, focusing on saltwater strains, and also from a land usage standpoint. And when you're talking about corn and soy and sugarcane as being the basis for almost all the biofuels in this country and throughout the world, you use a lot of land and fresh water. And after air, fresh water is the most valuable resource we need as humans to survive. And so we're very excited to be here and to get the word out about what we're doing at Cellana and the rest of the algae biomass industry as we charge forward to commercialization.
So Martin, just one follow-up, and thank you for that introduction. As folks here think about how biofuels fit into a sustainable transportation future, we're already aware of the role that ethanol plays within the gasoline markets and biodiesel, as you mentioned, current generation of biodiesel in the distillate market. Where do you see advanced biofuels like algae-based biofuels fitting in, and when do you see them starting to play a major role in California's fuel infrastructure?
Two very good questions. And so we like algae-based fuels that emphasize the oil. It's a more energy-dense chemical. And I don't have to probably explain to most in the audience here that ethanol, you know, love it or hate it, it certainly is part of our energy mix in this country. Brazil has done a very good job expanding that to become an even larger part of their energy economy. But you only get about two-thirds the miles per volumetric gallon. And there are some serious issues with storage and transportation given the fact that it tracks water and it's not very compatible with our existing infrastructure. And so the nice thing about algae strains that Cellana and others are emphasizing is they make a very energy dense oil, which is a great feedstock for things like biodiesel or renewable diesel or other, or gasoline, renewable gasoline and the like. And it's more compatible with existing infrastructure. It's truly a drop-in fuel opportunity. Now, there are others in the algae space addressing ethanol from the sugar part of what's in this bottle right here, but again, it's just not as good a fuel. So we see an algae oil-based fuel as a no-compromise type of a fuel that can drop in today. The trick is to get it at a competitive price. And if you ask Neste why they signed up with Cellana as their first large-scale customer agreement, they'll tell you because it was not just about the sustainability from an environmental standpoint, but it was the first, in their minds, credible opportunity to get a commercially priced, a competitively priced, non-subsidized fuel-grade oil so that they could meet both their environmental requirements but didn't have to pay a premium for it. Now, while my message in the industry may not be as well received by others here, we're gearing this for no carbon tax or cost. We think that a tax or a price on carbon could accelerate deployment. Subsidies will help accelerate commercialization, but I'd really not like Cellana or the rest of the algae fuel industry to be dependent on ongoing subsidies because it limits the ability to predict and scale, I think, not just in the US, but throughout the world. But based on this multi-product model anchored by a very high-value product, we could be commercial, Ryan, today with enough financing from the Kleiners and other private equity sources out there. And so it really could be, you know, in the next 2 to 5 years, then you'd start talking about things that we can talk about on the panel. Where do you actually scale? Where are the best places to get financed, to get permitted? And I think California has some of those features in terms of geography and the demand side in terms of renewable fuels. I think the challenge that we're seeing, and others in the room as I've talked to on the developer side, have to do with things like permitting and the uncertainty and de-risking the deployment timelines, which are critical to getting capital in this environment, particularly after the crash of
08. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you, Martin. Appreciate the overview. I want to transition next to Andrew and offer Andrew the opportunity to introduce ATDynamics. Andrew, since Martin had a product sample, I'm expecting you to unfold a trailer tail from your jacket.
If don't mind walking out back, we have a tractor trailer. No, we don't actually. But just, I guess, to start, just a quick show of hands, how many people are in the trucking industry in the audience? Okay, great. So I also did not used to be in the trucking industry. My focus was actually on electric vehicles and wind energy and fuel cells. And then when looking to start a green technology company, I was introduced to a gentleman, and it turned out there was a handful of frustrated aerodynamicists around the world who had spent the last 25 years trying to address a very simple fact. And that is that the very worst shape you can pull down the highway at 55 or 65 miles an hour is a big rectangular box. And yet in the United States, there's about 2 million rectangular boxes circulating the highway network every day and about another 2 million long-haul trailers worldwide. So being not from the trucking industry, I immediately threw together a business plan. And in 6 months, we were all going to be famous, and every trailer would have tails on the back of them. What we learned is in a very capital-intensive, low-margin, highly competitive industry, introducing a new shape to a semi-trailer is actually a bit more of a hill to climb. Mm. But our team is extremely proud to say that in the last 6 to 18 months, changes have occurred in the industry that we've created some early adopter fleets, and I'll talk about what the device is in a second. The industry has woken up of the opportunity of aerodynamics, and after a few early adopter fleets started putting these changes on their trailers, we now think that our prediction is coming through that essentially every trailer running U.S. highways will be much more aerodynamic and streamlined and have tails coming off the back of them like ski racer or bike racer's helmet in the year to come. So for the people that have seen them, you'll know what I'm talking about. Our company specifically has been focused on a device called a trailer tail. It sticks about 4 feet off the back of the semi-trailer. It reduces the low pressure suction that occurs on the back flat surface of the trailer and improves fuel economy by about 5 to 6%. On a global basis, over the next 10 years, at a net profit to industry and consumers, we can reduce fuel expenditures by about 40 billion or about 10 billion gallons of diesel fuel at a net profit, and it's a complete no-brainer. So keep your eye out. Don't invite me back to this panel in 3 years if the majority of trailers you see out there do not have tails on the back of them.
Will you be a frustrated aerodynamicist?
I will be a frustrated aerodynamicist. But I guess I'll just make another comment about the the industry and the adoption curve that we face. What we realized early on in the process was how much of the challenge of bringing a technology to market is not the great idea, but actually some of the hurdles that are not the non-obvious ones. A lot of people said, well, the low price of fuel was the reason these didn't come out 20 years ago. And we found that really wasn't the case. It had more to do just with some of the incentives of how trucking companies are structured, who saves the fuel. The owners of a trucking company love the idea of higher MPG, but your typical maintenance person doesn't want to deal with a piece of equipment breaking down. So we've really honed in as a company with this product and products to come about how you take something that's a real clean tech, great idea, and turn it into just some truck component.
Got it. Well, thank you very much, Andrew. Dimitrios, if you don't mind, please give us an introduction on ChargePoint, and we're excited to hear about any potential co-branding opportunities that you executed while you're at Virgin America with EV charging, because we certainly need to spice it up.
Well, I am working on that. First, let me say thank you, Ryan, for moderating this panel, and it's really great to be here with these gentlemen on this panel, and thank you to Advanced Energy Economy for having us here too. This is a really great forum for us to come together and look at ways that we can sort of move energy forward, not just in California, but of course across the country and globally. That said, I don't have any props, but I will do a focus group like Andrew. So I'm going to ask how many people drive an EV here in the audience. Okay, so I won the truck battle, I guess.
Nice.
and how many people are familiar with ChargePoint? How many people charge at ChargePoint stations? More than people who said they had cars. That's probably a good thing for us. So I'll tell you a little bit about ChargePoint. ChargePoint's a six-year-old company that is essentially in a three-year-old industry. ChargePoint is a EV charging services company. What's really unique about ChargePoint is the way we approach doing our business. We're kind of multiple companies in one. Most of you would be familiar with the idea of the infrastructure, the hardware. You plug your EV into a charging station. ChargePoint is the leader in that space. We have a 60% market share, so most of the charging stations you see in the public are ours. We're also a SaaS company. We provide the network that connects all the charging stations and handles everything from billing, payment remittance, usage reporting, access control, meaning who gets to charge on the station, when do they get to charge on it, do they pay money or not to charge on it. So, and then lastly, we're in the social media space too, because we provide mobile apps that allow drivers to not only locate where charging stations are, but to find charging stations that are actually available. No one wants to navigate to a station that isn't available, so the network becomes really important. In addition to that, with our next iteration of the mobile app coming out, we're going to offer a whole host of new functionality that will connect our driver community and allow them to get access to hosts, as we call companies that own charging stations, and get special deals from them. So imagine if you're in the locality of a Target store and can get an exclusive deal at Target by being part of the ChargePoint network, which of course Target is. So we're covering the gamut of that, and the reason we do that is because we're a consumer-focused company. We believe deeply, although we're in an emerging industry and we're in an industry that requires policy and in some cases financial investment from the government, we believe very deeply in letting the market decide and letting consumers decide. So we're very, very focused on the entire EV ecosystem and really developing a scalable, sustainable business model that will really advance the number of charging stations that are being offered. We're somewhat limited, of course, by the fact that you need cars in order to have charging stations, and you get into the proverbial chicken and egg problem. But we're not as concerned answering that question, because the answer is both. If you have more cars, there's more charging stations. If you have more charging stations, more cars will come. What really matters is getting out there and educating consumers. So we're very focused on the consumer side.
Thank you very much for the overview, Dimitrios. Curt, tell us a little bit more about the Alliance for Automobile Manufacturers. And, you know, this panel today, in the long term, what we're talking about is trying to figure out how to get to this 80% reduction by 2050. And we've got three California companies, California and Hawaii, representing novel technology-based approaches. You represent the entire industry of manufacturers that make transportation products. What's your perspective on how you incorporate those existing manufacturers, as well as some of these high-tech startups, into that long-term vision of 2050 in a way that works for the entire industry?
Well, that's a very interesting question. And again, I want to thank everyone for the invitation here as well. Very briefly, the Alliance of Automobile Manufacturers is an association of the 12 largest automakers in approximately about 80% of the cars sold in the United States. We are their representative both on legislative and regulatory matters, as well as some of the policy matters that Ryan mentioned with safety and clean air and et cetera. The central question you asked is the one that our companies are facing every day. We have some fantastic products that are on the cusp of coming out. And kind of reflecting on what Mary Nichols had said, a couple things that I was going to say that she said, it bears repeating a little bit, is that the technology that our companies are producing is incredible. She stated that 99% of the emissions that come out of the tailpipe have been eliminated in the last 20 to 30 years. And think about that, that's pretty dramatic. I mean, that means almost nothing is coming out of the tailpipe compared to what it was 30 years ago. And then also significant is the challenges that we have in the one national standard program that we worked out with President Obama, with the Air Resources Board, and the leadership of Senator Pavley, who had a bill over 10 years ago that was the impetus of all that. We're going to be doubling the gas mileage that's going to be required for a car, in addition to what California and other states have adopted as the zero emission vehicle standard. That's just as simple as it says, zero emission. We have a tremendous challenge. And you've mentioned the 80% by 2050. We have a mandate of 100% by 2040. Our cars, to meet those goals of 80%, we will have to have a zero emission fleet by 2040. Our companies have a tremendous challenge. And so we look to companies like that the three gentlemen represent, as well as our own companies. And it is a very exciting time. We're going to see in the next several years an explosion of products that are just basically being out there. You know, there's a handful of you who have electric vehicles. There's going to be hydrogen vehicles that are going to be available for sale in about a year and a half. That's another very exciting one. Compressed natural gas is also an option. And as Mary said, there's the old internal combustion engine that is going to still be the warhorse of our transportation movements. But it's going to be a much cleaner process. So how are we going to achieve the zero emission vehicle standards, where our companies literally will be producing hundreds of thousands of vehicles in the next few years to meet the 15% goal that's been established, and then ultimately the 100% goal by 2040. And we look at all these solutions, everything, the biodiesel, electric, even the aerodynamics and the vehicle sizing and lightweighting of vehicles, it's all part of the mix. And our companies are throughout the world doing that. But they're also, which a lot of people don't realize, are here in California as well. Many of the design centers of both our domestic and foreign companies are here. They have significant research centers, especially in Palo Alto, that are having dramatic improvements on vehicle mileage standards and bringing these new technologies to the road. So again, it's a very exciting time for auto industry and the consumers. And I think that's kind of the next step, and it's been mentioned, is to get that acceptance. There are a lot of challenges getting people to accept these new technologies. And that's part of our challenge and our partners' challenges to get these cars on the road.
You know, Curt, one of the developments that I think is very exciting in the transportation technology sector is the convergence of IT and transportation, that we're going from a world where cars are basically a dead node on a network. There's really no way to directly interact with them. You know, ChargePoint is an example of a company that's using consumer mobile app product development to help people access refueling infrastructure, and that's not how gasoline and diesel works. You know, I'm sure your members are seeing this every day, this tension between getting more connectivity into the car, being able to measure more things in the car, know more about the efficiency of the car, while doing it all safely, such that you're not watching YouTube and checking your Facebook while you're going 85.
It is a huge challenge, both from the actual mechanical aspect of it, but also from the public policy. On the mechanical side, our customers are wanting more and more vehicles, but safety is the paramount concern of all of our companies. And just as you say, there are inherent conflicts in those two, and we're working very specifically on that. There are, in fact, bills last year and this year in this California state legislature that were in conflict with each other on what would be allowable technology and safety issues. And so we're working both with state governments as well as the federal government, with the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, to help develop some of those standards. And there are some other things that also, besides just fueling technologies, but the whole autonomous vehicle technology is out there, where this self-driving cars are legal in California, Nevada, and Florida. There are companies, as well as companies like Google, are working together to have that technology. And that's part of that is safety driven, but also a lot of it is more fuel efficient. If the traffic flow is going, that increases the energy efficiency, and there's not the start and the stop and the accidents, et cetera, and all that. So that, while it's not one concept that may naturally be linked with energy efficiency, that is really, again, one of the more interesting ideas that's is coming to our roads and will be here in the near future.
I think it's a very exciting sector. Kleiner Perkins as a firm has made two separate investments in just traffic-related IT companies, in companies like Waze and Inrix, and I think the rough numbers are about $80 billion worth of fuel wasted per year due to congestion. So it's a massive opportunity, and we see the same type of smart grid-like opportunity in the transportation grid. But it's a lot more complicated when you're talking about motor vehicles and all of the temptations that IT can bring in a car as well. But I would agree, it's a fascinating area and one that's full of policy challenges. Andrew, you said something in your introduction that reminded me of a question we deal with a lot when we talk to growth stage companies, and everyone's been polling the audience, so I wanted to do a quick poll. How many people think it would be a good idea to profitably put trailer tails on every brick that we drag down the highway and save all that fuel and money? So we think that's a pretty good idea that nobody really minds.
There's no customers in the whole audience.
All of you go out and start a trucking company. There's no real objection. I mean, I'm sure somewhere you could find a contingent of people who object to, what would that be, a trapezoid or a parallelogram versus a rectangle? Right. But with the exception of that camp, probably everyone else thinks it's a really good idea to improve the aerodynamic efficiency of trailers. We see a lot of companies, and I'm sure those of you who are investors or policymakers or CEOs, see a lot of companies where the spreadsheet works. The payback is there. And it may be under 4 years, which for an industrial company, you know, try to find an investment right now that's going to grow to give you a 4-year payback. So, Andrew, the rhetorical question is, when are we going to see, or what is, if it's such a good idea, why won't every company save themselves money, be more profitable, be greener, and put a trailer tail on?
Yes, and like I said, it was coming into an industry, you sometimes, especially when something's so obvious, and I know most people here, if you could invest in a stock that you put $2,000 in, and every year you get $2,000 to $4,000 back, that's a good stock. So why is that not an obvious investment? So I started to allude to it in the introduction, but I'll dive into that, because I really, I talk about people in general are very good, but lots of people have very bad incentives. So I'll just dive into this incentive piece a little deeper. I would go and meet with the head of the largest trucking companies in the country. They would be totally supportive of this idea, and then no project would move forward. And we realized there were these individuals, literally the people that manage the largest trucking fleets in the country, that did not get any financial incentive for making a trucking fleet more profitable, but had all the financial incentive in the world to spend less money or not have anything damaged in the field or break down in the middle of Nebraska. And So it's sort of a strange thing, but simply, the reason there's 15,000 trailer tails on the road today is because in 2010, after showing these efficiency benefits to literally a dozen trucking companies and nobody doing anything, I finally sat down with the owner of a company which is a real outlier in that he has put fuel economy as a key part of their culture throughout the whole organization. And that fleet was the first fleet. We'd only sold 6 units to any one company before. He ordered 3,500 that day because he was, I always say you take a group of 100 customers and you shake them, and there's about 2 to 3 customers that fall out the bottom that are really willing to do something different after analyzing the results. The other 97% or 98% want to see someone else do it before they dive in. So incentives an issue, following the leaders an issue. And then finally, there's some other pieces of industry that we sort of learned along the way. There's a lot of cases where a trucking company will own their trailers, but they will have drivers that own their own trucks and pay for their own fuel. Why would I ever upgrade my trailers to be more aerodynamic if somebody else is paying for the fuel? So what we learned as the solution to that is, number one, make sure your product's really good and find those 2% of customers, and then focus like crazy, and you can start this ball rolling down the hill. And I'll throw out a final piece, which has to do with urgency. You can have a fantastic idea that can save a trucking company tons of money, but why, when that executive walks into his office that day, is he going to focus on starting a brand new project versus fixing the 100 other things that are on his desk? And I had an interesting conversation last night about all the great things that Virgin America and ChargePoint and Apple had done, but it's really true on the marketing side. It's kind of interesting, even for these industrial products, figuring out how to make them be very, very cool, mm-hmm. such that it becomes a priority before the next trade show or before the next time an executive's with the other leaders in their group. I think it applies to trucking as much as it applies to a group of electric utility companies getting together or anything else. There's a certain amount of peer pressure and marketing and generating buzz that also moves an industry forward. So those are a couple ideas.
I appreciate that. Dimitrios, we've got one question from the audience for you and then one from me as well. The first one is, you know, as a neutral third party of charging infrastructure, are you able to track the impact of electricity consumption? The question basically is, can I understand how much renewable electricity I'm consuming in my vehicle versus fossil fuels? Because electricity on our grid mix today is not clean. Do you provide some sort of ability for people to have an understanding of where the fuel behind the electricity comes from? And then the second question from me is just, how do you think about, you know, in some ways keying off of what Andrew described, how do you think about finding those enterprises, maybe it's the retail outlet that's willing to do something a little bit more innovative to cater to drivers of plug-in vehicles? And, you know, how do you get them to move? Because when we look at the numbers, we're now running along at about 10,000 plug-in vehicles a month in the United States. Mm-hmm. We had an era where the eggs were coming before the chickens. We got some chargers out there. Then we had some chickens come out. I was at Tesla at the time. We were manufacturing some of the early chickens. But now it seems like we are outpacing the infrastructure. So first question is just for folks who are interested in the long-term sustainability of the plug-in vehicle and they don't want to necessarily enable a fleet of coal-fired power plants to drive their EV. And then second one is just, how do you find these private partners to put out charging? Because it seems to me that the cars are now arriving. And you know, there are 2 new cars coming out from BMW soon that look pretty exciting. There's going to be a Cadillac as well soon. What do we do to move this faster?
Well, first let me say that's a very premium chicken that you were putting out there in the marketplace.
It was a free range.
Organic free range.
Yeah.
But so to answer your questions, and maybe I'll answer them in reverse order. I'll talk about the partnerships first, and what we can do with consumers. I think what's really important now, it's really about education. You know, when you start moving from an emerging market, which is taking, let's say, government money to fund, and then you move along and then you start taking government investment maybe as loans or something. But now we're at a point where it's really about, if you're going to win, you have to win with consumers and you have to have a value proposition. The value proposition for different verticals is really clear. In retail, for instance, which I think maybe aligns to what your question was about, is how do you get people to bring on charging stations to help them attract customers? And what we're finding now is, as the market starts to mature, it starts to consolidate around a few companies that really have a sustainable, scalable model and are really delivering value. What we're finding is that the market is dictating, and they're asking for things like, well, I need to drive my business. So a retailer says, I need to attract more customers, I need to drive more business. So we've done things where we would put charging stations in with retailers and say, let's do a test. Let's see how long your average customer spends in your store. Let's see how much money they spend on average. Shockingly, the longer someone's in your store, the more money they spend. So once they understood that putting the charging station in allows a customer to stay longer, that's a benefit. An additional benefit was they realized they were starting to get people who wouldn't normally come to their store to stay. So you're getting a new customer who stays longer and spends more money. So there's a really clear value proposition for the retail space. Workplace, you know, I'm sure a lot of you understand the value proposition there. In the workplace, it's all about helping attract and retain employees, right? It also, if companies have sustainability programs, then charging infrastructure aligns to that. If companies are really concerned about their corporate image and want to seem like a forward-thinking company, a good example is a company like Evernote, which actually I think even leases EVs for their employees, or offers to lease EVs for their employees. Then the infrastructure makes a lot of sense. So it's really about providing what the market needs. Kind of pivoting maybe to the first question you asked, we do provide, because we are a software company, essentially, what we provide is all the information around usage for your electricity. So if you're a driver, absolutely, you can log in. If you have a ChargePoint account, you can log in and you can see your energy consumption, and you can see the carbon greenhouse gases that you are avoiding. You can see the fuel consumption, gasoline, that you are not, that you avoided as well. So you're able to see the impact that you're having, and you're able to track the goodness you're sort of putting back into the environment. And the same, of course, goes for our customers who actually buy the charging stations, who really need to understand what the usage is, because they need to be able to moderate how much power they're dispensing to drivers that are plugged into their charging stations. Because as you can imagine, if you're Google, for instance, is one of our largest customers, if you've got hundreds and hundreds of cars plugged into a station, you know, during peak hours, you can incur some very significant energy costs. So the ability to mitigate that, to track what you're doing and offset those loads, is going to become really important. So it's really comes down to two things. It's about education, and making sure people understand the benefit of what it can do. And then secondly, is you can't have education without information. So being a company that can provide that education and clearly let consumers know what they're getting for their money is how we're going to win and how we're going to make sense in this market.
So, Dimitrios, on the earlier panel, there was a lot of discussion around integration and the ability to dynamically control the power side. Because you're putting in networked EV charging, mm-hmm. is this going to help provide some of the linkage between the smart grid on the power side and the smart grid on the vehicle side?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a marketing guy, but the short answer is absolutely yes, it will. I don't know any other way that's going to happen. If you don't have this intelligent charging network that connects to the grid, it's the only way for a station owner. And as the market matures, see, originally what's been happening in the first few years of this industry is people do it because there's some government money out there, or they put sort of one in to check the box on saying, look, I'm cool, look, I can attract someone. But as the market really takes root and it becomes a real market and the cars are on the road, now we're kind of getting to this next level where people are saying, oh, holy crap, I got to manage this stuff. Now I've got 50, 100 drivers coming here. I need to really understand how much power I'm using. I need to efficiently manage my expenses. I need to efficiently manage who gets to use my charging stations. So it becomes really, really, really important in order to manage your business to really understand what these, what the cost implications are. So being connected to the grid through our network is absolutely vitally important. And that's what we're seeing. Our customers are choosing that for us. Our customers are now telling us that they need more information as they put more charging stations out there.
Got it. Martin, you know, we've heard that Andrew's customer has 99 problems every day, and Andrew's trying to get them focused on aerodynamics. Dimitrios has a mix of different customers. Sometimes they're retail, sometimes they're public sector, sometimes they're private owners. You recently signed a large offtake agreement, and I would say that kind of that's the ultimate B2B customer. Can you tell us a little bit more about that agreement and also the process that you used to close that? Because that seems like some pretty heavy lifting, but a necessary step for a biofuel or biotechnology company to execute.
Sure. So it is hard to sort of pre-sell roughly $100 million worth of oil that does not currently exist from facilities that have not been built. So it is a heavy lift.
Yeah, just culturally, a startup dealing with an oil company in Finland.
Right.
I mean, that's an interesting mix.
Well, and here I think, and again, we're three private company CEOs or senior executives, and hopefully all of us do believe strongly in the market being the ultimate arbiter of what's going to win and what's going to survive. And ideally, if we could do this on an unsubsidized basis, it'll come faster and be more sustainable than not. In the case, though, of the oil majors, whether they're European or US-based, I think the mandates do play a big role to try and shift over to lower carbon, more renewable feedstocks. And, you know, I think that for me, it was critical to be working with a European company. They're a bit more forward-leaning in my mind than some of the American companies. It's not that, so our largest deal up until the Neste offtake was with Shell Oil. Very much focused on fuel, fuel, fuel. I like to joke as the three products that they seem to be most interested in. The challenge, though, is that at fuel, fuel, fuel types of business models, your costs of production have to be probably 1/10 what they actually are today for Cellana and other companies to produce this bottle of starting algae to begin with. And processing it doesn't make your cost structure any better. And so I think that the critical factor in getting the offtake deal done, which does cover up to tens of thousands of tons of oil, so these are dozens of millions of gallons, it's still literally a drop in the bucket, but it's a start. It was hard, and frankly, the minimum volumes that we're looking to produce are probably hundreds of tons a year. These are amounts that are trivial or annoyingly small, but Neste, to its credit, because they have clear mandates in the EU, and because other renewable feedstocks like Malaysian palm are really not very sustainable in the short, medium, and long term, they really felt like they had to go to something that was better, such as algae. The trick was finding something that they could purchase at a market price. And so the types of mechanisms that we establish with them, I think, are very innovative and serve as a model, not just for Cellana looking at its feed and omega-3 deals, but also for others in the advanced biofuel industry. There's not a fixed price contract. It's going to be based on what the market price is of a reference product like petroleum or Malaysian palm. And it's based on flexible specifications. So if we hit the maximum specs relative to a petroleum or palm, we'll get the market price. If we hit minimum specs such that they can still blend away some of the impurities, then we'll get the minimal price, and there are infinite number of intermediate zones there. And that's important because for us, you know, the net revenue that we're getting from this is 10 times what we could get if we were just going after oil. We can get something like $6 to $10 a kilo, but the maximum you're gonna get, even at $100 a barrel, that's 60 to 70 cents a kilo. And you can see how, you know, business models that might work at $6 a kilo revenue total for the three products we mentioned don't really work for 60 cents. Mm-hmm. And we're like that too. We're probably showed them a cost structure somewhere between $2 to $5 a kilo for just getting to this bottle right here. And so this is the first model they've seen that will allow them to get that fuel-grade oil essentially as a byproduct. So this is very different than companies that are out there, some of whom are very successful, some of whom are financed by Kleiner, where fuel is the primary or sometimes exclusive revenue source. And that just puts tremendous pressure on current costs, current yields, and current prices in the marketplace. And I think it's going to be very challenging for companies out there that are relying on sugar feedstocks, in the case of fermentation companies, versus companies that can have a byproduct or waste product model as they address fuel. One example, we talked about Brazil. So one of the cheapest sources of sugar in the world is Brazilian sugar from sugarcane. But the Brazilian real price of sugar has gone up about 75% in 5 years and almost 300% in the last 15 years. So until we get, you know, to the promised land of cheap sugars from lignocellulose, you know, that's going to be very challenging for fuel-focused or fuel-exclusive business models. You know, the cheap sugars are kind of like unicorns. They're great on paper, but they don't currently exist. And so I think that's really the long-term solution to really expand, I think. But we're nowhere close to that, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think it's incredibly challenging, and I think Mary Nichols described it earlier very well. When you think about how little useful work is done by liquid fuel, it lets you know how cheap liquid fuel must be if we can afford to burn it so wastefully. So there are very few liquids, if you just go into a grocery store, that are as cheap as petroleum fuel. And we've built up an infrastructure that is completely dependent on the idea that liquid fuel will be cheap and plentiful. And so perhaps if we get a little bit of the efficiency side going with efforts like ATDynamics, and we can move a little farther with a drop of fuel, we can afford to burn better fuels. But currently, it's a tough cost problem.
I think that's right. And that's why we're so enthusiastic at Cellana on this multi-product model anchored by our liquid gold omega-3s. It is not ultimately a way to scale, get the energy scale, and to make tens of billions of gallons of fuel-grade oil. But it can get you probably to something north of a billion gallons. Right. And it can pay back in that four-year time frame so that we can at least get started with commercialization today. And the vision I have for Cellana is a bit like the British Empire. The sun shall never set on Cellana. The sun is shining 24 hours a day somewhere on Earth. And so we want to dot the globe with algae farms that can address these multiple products. Once they've paid back, conceivably, with improvements in economics based on scale, improvements in yield based on time with strains, and what we all conceive, I think, over the long haul of more expensive oil or fuel sources as well as protein for food, that other models such as a two-product model of just fuel and feed, or even just an all-fuel model or an all-feed model, might become more apparent and viable in the second or third decade of this technology. But this is something which we think will characterize the first commercializing companies like Cellana, which we hope to get a first-mover advantage with our advanced state of development, although we're not commercial yet.
Got it. I see. We've just got a few minutes left. We got a great question from the audience, and I know we have a lot of policymakers in the audience that are interested in this topic. So what we're going to do, Curt, I'm going to ask you to convene the first meeting of the Clean Transportation Automobile Alliance. I'm going to ask our three founding members to give you really quickly the top two policy barriers to furthering the use of their technology. And I'm going to ask you just for some help in how they can think about approaching Sacramento or DC or even local policymakers for some thoughtful discussions about how to move this forward. I think all of these markets that are represented here have seen some successful policy development. I mean, we have seen really the first meaningful heavy trucking standards come out. We've seen a variety of different incentives on the EV side. Some have worked well, some haven't. Same on the charging side as well. And we have renewable fuel standard, and we have subsets of that for advanced biofuels as well. But real quick, let's give Curt your two pain points, and let's get Curt's expert opinion on how we should be approaching policymakers for help with these. So Dimitrios, why don't we start with you?
Sure. I would say number one, Curt, would be that we need to have it be cheaper to get infrastructure into the ground. And a great way to make it cheaper to get infrastructure in the ground is to have policy that will encourage EV readiness. So on parking permit leases, new leases, construction leases, on all of those things, if if things are made EV ready, parking lots are pre-wired, it takes half the cost out of the equation because the installation becomes significantly cheaper. So we need policy that really encourages this EV readiness. I think the second thing that we really need is programs from the government. I think we're kind of living in a world now where the government money is just sort of, again, something to fund is drying up. What we really need is policies that will get behind a winning idea and partner. So sort of market, public market-based policies that will enable a really good idea that can be led by a company like us that has the private capital, but we can take government money and leverage that money and do a lot more with it to get infrastructure in the ground. So policy that will get behind that and allow these new ways to finance to get infrastructure into the ground and ensuring EV readiness. Those would be the two things that we'd like to see done that can significantly increase not just our business, but get more EV drivers in the road and get us off fossil fuels faster.
Andrew, two quick requests for the
shopping
list.
I'll do one since we're low on time here. I believe incredibly strongly in setting very aggressive targets in the future that you can depend on being there throughout that time period. So there is absolutely no reason that transportation can't be 80% more efficient than it is today. Set those stakes in the ground and stick to it. That allows people to invest and do really dramatic things.
Maybe I'll do just one, too, given the time. But for me, thinking about it with my Californian hat on, San Diego, where I'm based physically, is sort of algae mecca for the whole world, and yet very few companies are deploying in Southern California for outdoor algae production. Part of it, I think, especially given the capital intensity and the constraint of raising other people's money, essentially, is that it's just not the easiest place to do business. Generally, high taxes, high regulation. I think that perversely, some of the well-intentioned environmental and other regulation that is supposed to impede bad development can overlap with the renewable energy technologies that those in the room here are trying to get out into the field. And if we don't do that, then we're stuck with the incumbent, dirty, fossil-based energy development. So I would like to see the cities, the counties, Sacramento, and the feds kind of get together and streamline the multiple overlapping regulatory regimes and attempt to try and accelerate the process of getting projects in Southern California permitted, where everyone gets kind of a shot bite at the apple at the same time rather than sequentially. And we don't like necessarily all getting sued by the private individuals after you're done with the public agencies too. So some way to help accelerate the permitting and deployment of these. It doesn't have to be all about subsidies. It can be about really just trying to do smart regulation in an environment where you have to go to too many regulatory agencies.
Okay. Well, Curt, we're out of time, so you're off the hook in solving these companies' problems today. But just as a wrap-up, are these the types of discussions that these executives can have with policymakers?
Absolutely. And in fact, every one of the issues that were addressed by these two gentlemen are actually being discussed in the legislature right now. The leadership by Senator Pavley and Assemblyman Perea on SB 11 and AB 8 are talking about those very things of getting the infrastructure. Senator Stein, and that's there also importantly, there are non-fiscal incentives, and you've touched on that.
Right.
And Senator Corbett's here today. She's going to lead the charge on a lot of that on the electric vehicles. So those are some real models that I think the other industries can take a look at to how to build a incredibly broad and diverse coalition of environmentalists, oil companies, car companies, air quality management districts are all behind these type of programs. And Senator Steinberg is leading the charge on some CEQA issues as well as Governor Brown on some of these reforms. So those issues are there. It's now just actually getting up here and doing it. I think the bottom line is you guys are so busy building up your businesses that you don't have the time to come up here to do that, and everybody recognizes that. And if there's some way that you can devote a little bit of that time to tell your very compelling stories to understand the policymakers, to see what they do, especially on the job creation front, that's the deal. And I know that's hard to do when you're all starting in businesses and trying to make money. So it's easy for me to sit here and say, come up here more often. But there are models that you can look at, especially in the EV world. That's what people are talking about.
I'm staying an extra night. I have room on my schedule for tomorrow for anyone who'd like to meet.
Well, thank you very much. We appreciate your time and attention during the panel. I want to thank Dimitrios, Andrew, Martin, Curt for joining us. Apologize for running a bit over, but when you've got the leading companies and executives from electric vehicle infrastructure, from heavy vehicle aerodynamics, from algae-based biofuels, it's tempting not to keep running. So thank you again, appreciate it, and thank you to the panelists.
Good job.
Thank you.